Good afternoon. Today I'm talking to you about our new strategies for allergic unmet clinical needs. I don't have, I think, to explain to you exactly what is allergic inflammation, just to remind you that it is present in diseases such as allergic asthma, rhinitis, conjunctivitis, of course in anaphylactic shock, and it happens when an atopic individual has come in contact with innocuous substances that are defined as allergens. The reactions, this is very important for me, is can be as an inflammation self-resolving, acute. However, in most of the cases, especially in severe asthma and atopic dermatitis that have been defined by WHO as a unmet clinical needs, it is chronic. Here you have some colorful picture of about allergies and allergens, and I show to you especially to remind you that we can be allergic to drugs. The two main effector cells are the mast cell and eosinophils, and for effector cells, I would like to say that are the cells that by releasing their mediator cause the symptoms of allergy. Of course, in this slide I'm going to show to you, you could stop allergic inflammation, and there have been trials to do that by modulating the immune response that atopic individuals have towards the allergen. So by modulating Th2 cells, by modulating B cells, and so on and so forth. We took the approach to try to downregulate mast cell and eosinophil, and you see we put these two cells at the center of our universe. We defined this, and I am going to explain to you the allergic effector unit, and that is created during the late phase of allergies, the early phases only due to the mast cells, and they stay together in the tissue when the reaction becomes chronic. To help the reactions to become chronic, we have also invading microbes such as S. aureus, that is the most defined bacteria invading atopic tissues. Fungi, we just studied in our lab Candida albicans, and perhaps viruses such as SARS-CoV-2. Strategies to stop the effector cells, the mast cell and eosinophils, has been taken in the past, and the stopping means also to stop the inflammatory and damaging effects that the mediators of mast cell and eosinophil have. So, in the older strategies that are still used today, we can have beta-2 receptor agonist, anti-muscarinic receptor for the symptoms of asthma. These effects are caused by the release of histamine, of leukotrienes, of tryptase, and so forth and so on. There was a not so successful trial to use so-called mast cell stabilizing agents such as the chromones. We still use and quite successfully anti-inflammatory drugs such as glucocorticosteroid together with anti-leukotriene, and of course the antihistaminic anti-H1 in atopic dermatitis, in allergic conjunctivitis and rhinitis. The newer strategies, again, just to remind you to understand what we are doing different from the new strategies, have been to use anti-IgE antibodies to stop activation of mast cell via IgE, to use anti-IL-5 antibodies neutralizing all receptor to stop differentiation, activation of eosinophils, anti-IL-4 and anti-IL-13 that are also anti-fibrotic agents because fibrosis develops also in asthma and in atopic dermatitis because we have tissue damage, and when nothing helps, patients are also giving anti-TNF-alpha antibody and even imatinib. In spite of all this, that are used, these new drugs that are used in a personalized way, that it means that if a patient has a lot of IgE, you will give the anti-IgE. If it is a eosinophilic asthma, you will give anti-IL-5 and so on. We don't have still the magic bullet, and there are still research concerning how to stop the release mediators of muscles, how to stop perhaps the signal transduction of muscle and eosinophils, and chemotaxis of eosinophils, so forth and so on. What is the allergic effector unit? So, by concentrating on the two effector cells of allergy, we found that indeed in human tissues, we always study first of all human, muscle and eosinophils are together and are seen in couples, in physical couples, during the late phase and chronic stages of allergy. And this staying together is not just staying together, each other fuels each other, they have increased survival, increased activation, they are activated muscle also if there is no IgE. And this, during the year, we have defined as due to soluble mediator. For example, we found that eosinophil produce stem cell factors, that is the survival factor for the muscles. The eosinophil produce MBP, that activates the muscle via beta-2 integrin. Muscles activate eosinophil specifically by tryptase, that causes their synthesis of interleukin-8, interleukin-6. However, this is not enough, and this showed to us that we could stop the effects, the pro-inflammatory effect of one cell on the other, but in the long term, we should have multiple pharmacy. When we find this sort of immunological synapse between muscle and eosinophil, we try to identify the receptor ligands. As the most important ones that we have identified when also studying is the CD48 on muscle and the 2B4 on eosinophil that cause all what I say to you in the pro-inflammatory allergic effector unit. And please note that serendipity also eosinophil have CD48, and CD48 we found is also a receptor for S. aureus. Besides that, my idea was to look for inhibitor receptors, the ones that you know from cancer immunology, spesso on NK, spesso on T killer cells. And we found, luckily enough, two main receptors, CTLA-4 and CD300A, that are expressed on both muscle and eosinophil, together with their ligands. To tell the truth, in mild to moderate allergic patients, some of the present current drugs control the symptoms and even the disease exacerbations, but none, even the newest approaches, can lead towards a resolution, even when the allergen avoidance is possible. Moreover, you have to know that asthma and atopic dermatitis are highly heterogeneous, complicating the diagnosis and the subsequent therapy. Therefore, there is a need for better therapeutic targets, and our idea is to use two complementary approaches that are to activate specifically inhibitor receptor expressed on muscle and eosinophil with agonistic antibodies and to enhance pro-resolving mediators levels. So, what is CTLA-4 and CD300A? Are two inhibitor receptors belonging to the immunoglobulin superfamilies. They have, of course, ITIM sequences. They were defined, as I say, on natural killer, on T cells, on B cells, and we are the one who found them expressed in their functionality on muscle, eosinophil, and basophils. The ligand of CD300A is phosphatidyl-L-ethanolamine, phosphatidylserine, that importantly are expressed on activated cells, virus-infected cells, and apoptotic cells, while the ligand of CTLA-4 is transformed sialic acid. I show very fast the CD7 because it's more important for me is the CD throughout the day. But by showing that I show what we usually do, we see first if it is expressed on human muscles. These are core brain-derived muscles, primary foreskin muscle, also transform muscle. Then we see the function by adding our activating antibody to Ig sensitize and Ig and antigen challenge CBNC. We see a dose response decrease in release of tryptase, in release of GM, CSF, and PGD2. The same with eosinophil. We found that peripheral blood eosinophils of patient, but also of normal health individuals, express Cyclex7. You see also CD300A, and also we took as a control another inhibitory receptor, Cyclex8. Specifically, Cyclex7 is increased in expression by gene CSF and IL-5 that are the eosinophil survival cytokines, so the allergic microenvironment. By activating Cyclex7 on the membrane eosinophil, we see decrease of EPX, that is one of the basic protein contained in the eosinophil granules, and of TNF-alpha. CD300A is a receptor I am more in love with because it's very special. Already many years ago, we found that its activation on human muscle, on human eosinophil, by a distinct signal transduction mechanism involving recruitment of phosphatases, SHP1 and SHP1. Decrease their activation to release mediators and survival. Now, we have been trying to be specific to deactivate only muscle or only eosinophil. So my students at the time synthesized by chemical synthesis bispecific antibodies, anti-IgE to bring the anti-CD300A specifically to muscle in allergic individuals, anti-CKIT, and CD300A or anti-CCR3 for the eosinophil. And in vitro and in vivo models of asthma, of atopic dermatitis, of allergic peritonitis, they saw that indeed there was an abrogation of the allergic reactions. More recently, we saw to add to the relevance of the CD300A, we saw in atopic dermatitis, first of all, the CD300A receptor is as a level of gene very much increased in the lesional skin, while in the non-lesional was similar to the normals, because the body tries to express more of this receptor to try to downregulate physiological the too much inflammation. Also, we found as a level of the protein that CD300A is very much expressed in atopic dermatitis lesional skin, and this is due especially to eosinophil expression. By using mice CD300A knockout, we saw that mice in knockout had much more severe atopic dermatitis, having much more skin sickness and infiltration of eosinophil. We can see in this slide that also in asthma, important also in asthma, we have an increase of CD300A expression on peripheral blood eosinophils, and CD300A is increasing expression in hypoxic tissue on eosinophils and on muscle. And now I try to finish up with the resolution of inflammation. Resolution of inflammation, you know, it is an event taking place at the end of an acute event, and it is due mostly to the release of pre-inflammation resolving lipid mediators such as lipoxin, resolving, protecting, myosin, described especially by the lab of Charles Seurat. We have hypothesized that resolution can also be modulated via the activation of inhibitor receptors, such as CD300A, that is named a negative feedback receptor. That is expressed not only on mast cell and eosinophil, but many inflammatory cells. Together with that, we know that at least in asthma, patients with severe asthma don't produce enough lipid mediators. Therefore, first of all, we create a model of upper and lower airways inflammation, allergic inflammation in mice. We treated them with one of the pre-resolving lipid mediators, lipoxin B4, and we could see, this is a slide from the allergic rhinitis, but also in the asthma, we could see that there is, in mice treated with lipoxin A4 or dexamethasone, a decrease in infiltration of mast cell, a decrease in infiltration of eosinophils, and in vitro, indeed, lipoxin A4 decreases activation of mast cells and decreases the chemotaxis of eosinophils. Finally, I would like to see how CD200A can synergize with another lipid mediator, LX4, lipoxin A4. Because of this, we induce a model of allergic peritonitis, and we followed CD300A. As you can see here, as expressed by total cell numbers, we have a peak of inflammatory cell infiltration in peritoneum at 96 hours, and a decrease, a resolution at 144 hours. If we use the CD200A knockout mice, you can notice that the peak is the same, but at 144 hours, the inflammation is not resolved. We don't have our break, CD200A. Moreover, in the wild-type mice, you can see that there is an increase, the white points, an increase in expression of CD300A, peaking again at 96 hours and decreasing at 144. Most of the cells expressing CD300A in our allergic model were the eosinophils. Now, what happens to the eosinophils in resolution? They are the ones who are still high, as you can see in CD300A knockout mice. And by calculating the resolution index based on eosinophils, we can indeed see how CD300A has a retardation in resolution. Together with that, we have all the time an increase of lipoxin A4 in both the wild-type mice, but even more in the knockout, sort of trying to resolve inflammation even in the absence of CD300A, and also a modulation of LTX4 receptor, that is FPR2. That is a peak at 48 hours, but it is lower somehow in the CD300A knockout mice. To show even further that there is a crosstalk between CD300A and exogenous SPMs that can help in resolving inflammation, allergic inflammation, we saw that if we incubate cord blood mast cells or mouse mast cells with resolving the one that is SPMs, sharing the receptor with lipoxin A4, we have a decrease upon activation IgE mediated of the release of tryptase and also of TNF-alpha at later time points. So To conclude, in summary, we have shown the important role of muscle and eosinophil inhibitory receptor CDK7 in 300A and the effect of inhibiting functionality of these cells by agonistic monoclonal antibodies. Also important, we show that CD300A is a brake for allergic inflammation and together with that, a stimulant possibly in synergies with SPM or the physiological resolution mechanism. Therefore, I would like to propose that in allergic inflammation, but also in other diseases in which muscle and eosinophil have a prominent role in the etiopathogenesis, we can downregulate these cells by using agonist and specific targeted antibody to CD300A and CDK7, possibly together with exogenous SPMs. I didn't talk to you today about the other possibilities that we investigate, that is to decrease activation of the inhibitory receptor CD48. Just a last slide to thank my collaborator, especially my student Pier Giorgio Puzzovio, who is the one of the resolution of inflammation CD300A in my lab. Thank you very much for your attention.